Leanne White says, is supplementing with cyanocobalamin IM, I assume IM is intramuscular, is supplementing with cyanocobalamin intramuscularly dangerous if you have MTHFR? I've tried using methylcobalamin SL, which I'm guessing is sublingual, at high doses, but couldn't get my levels up. Thoughts? So, cyanocobalamin is cheap, and there's not really any clear evidence that it's harmful, but I just don't like the idea that it is cobalamin bound to cyanide. It's not found in the food supply, and forming cyanocobalamin and peeing it out is actually one of the main ways you detoxify cyanide. So even though it's very clear that cyanocobalamin can fix a dietary B12 deficiency, I have not found head-to-head studies comparing the different forms. I just can't get it. I can't wrap my mind around how the end product of cyanide detoxification that you pee out in the urine could possibly have as good a utilization rate as something that you are not trying to pee out in the urine. Like, I don't see how it's possible that the urinary loss of cyanocobalamin could not be higher than the other forms of cobalamin. So look, hydroxycobalamin is also relatively inexpensive. It's relatively easy to get as injections. And it is not an end product of detoxification. And it is found in very high concentrations in the food supply. The normal forms of vitamin B12 that you find in the diet from food are hydroxycobalamin and methylcobalamin in milk, and hydroxycobalamin and adenosylcobalamin in meat. So hydroxycobalamin is the most universal food form of cobalamin, and it is always a substantial part of the food supply. And it's cheaper, I'm pretty sure it's cheaper than methylcobalamin. So I would use intramuscular injections of hydroxycobalamin. And I don't know what your situation is, but I'm guessing that you have pernicious anemia or something that's making it harder to absorb it orally. I will say that I have no idea if sublingual B12 is absorbed. I mean, I'll look into it when I do the Mastering Nutrition episode on B12 upcoming in a month or two. I'll do a thorough review of that, but most B vitamins start their absorption in the stomach and then mostly absorb in the small intestine. In the case of B12, when you're dealing with food, you're absorbing it in the small intestine almost exclusively with intrinsic factor that's produced in your stomach. And in pernicious anemia, you have an autoimmune attack on the cells that make intrinsic factor. In gastritis, even subclinical gastritis, you have general inflammation in the stomach that hurts the production of intrinsic factor. So as long as you don't have corresponding small intestinal inflammation, then you should have normal expression of B12 transporters in the intestine. And actually, I take that back. The B12 transporters in the intestine are irrelevant if you don't have the intrinsic factor. So what's relevant is that even if the B12 transporters in the intestine don't work at all, you absorb about 1% of an oral dose of B12 in the small intestine. And so you're only going to get benefit out of megadosing the B12. There are almost no safety concerns about megadosing B12. There are fewer safety concerns about megadosing hydroxycobalamin than about megadosing methylcobalamin. So that's food for thought. Again, justifying the hydroxycobalamin. And I mean, you're talking, 1% of the dose. So But, you know, you never know if you also have small intestinal inflammation that's reducing that further. And there's not really any harm in taking big doses. So, like, I don't know, I'd start with a milligram of oral hydroxycobalamin, test that against your serum B12. If it's not moving your serum B12, see if 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 milligrams do. Because if they do, then taking that every day is going to be probably easier than, well, I mean, it depends on what you like, but you're probably going to like taking oral B12 more than you're going to like getting intramuscular injections. So I would see if raising the dose works first. I'd use oral hydroxycobalamin, and then if you have to use intramuscular, I would use hydroxycobalamin. Leanne follows up, yes, the cyanide factor freaks me out too. Thanks for your suggestion. I've struggled with gastritis. Thanks for the extra research. Yeah, if you know you have gastritis, then you definitely, definitely have B12 deficiency if it's an ongoing thing. Because so half the population has H. pylori. This is the principal cause of B12 deficiency among omnivores. So, you know, the main cause of B12 deficiency in vegans and vegetarians is being vegans and vegetarians. And the rates of B12 deficiency among vegans and vegetarians is like 70% of vegetarians and over 90% of vegans when you use high quality, rigorous functional markers of B12 deficiency. If you look for symptoms, it's way less than that, right? But the early biochemical evidence of B12 deficiency, 70% of vegetarians, over 90% of vegans. And then in omnivores, you have like 15 or 16% of the population who are B12 deficient. Most of them are elderly. And about 0.1% of the population and 1% of the people over 65 have pernicious anemia. So that's one important cause. But among omnivores, the main cause is gastritis. And this right here, what I'm about to say, is the main cause. Half of us are infected with H. pylori. Starting in childhood, the H. pylori causes subclinical gastritis. Every year of our life, it gets worse and it gets worse and it gets worse and it gets worse. But we're talking about such low levels of inflammation that you could make it to 65 and you still wouldn't have gastritis symptoms. Some of you would, some of us would, but most of the people who have the gastritis would not have symptoms even at this old age. And yet, by the time you're 65, about probably like 30% of the people who have H. pylori and 15% of the general population have subclinical gastritis bad enough to cause B12 deficiency. So if you know you have gastritis, then your gastritis is a lot worse than the gastritis that causes B12 deficiency. And so that's the big thing. But even with gastritis, very high megadoses of oral B12 should cause enough passive transport in the intestine to be absorbed at a meaningful level. And I guess you just have to judge it against, like, from a medical perspective, they're always worried about compliance because the general, you know, unlike the people who are showing up to this AMA, the general population has very low motivation compared to us. And so injection is preferable from that standpoint because there's fewer things to do, right? So you have, and plus you have an accountability buddy because someone's got to inject you. So you get an accountability buddy to do something once a month versus you have the personal responsibility to do something every day. From a compliance perspective, it's vastly superior to getting injected. But if you're already taking 15 supplements every morning, then it's probably way easier for you to just add megadose of B12 in with those oral supplements than to get an intramuscular injection. I'd prefer it. So thank you for